Hello everyone, hope you all are doing great. First of all, thank you for tuning in with RecRo. So today we have Tushar Agarwal with us, who's a computer scientist at Adobe for almost 9 months now, and he has also worked with LinkedIn. Today we have a session on how to crack interview of top tech companies. So Tushar will be helping us on how to prepare for these top companies and also how to prepare our resumes. And Tushar has almost 5+ years of experience as a software engineer in the IT industry. He has taken 100+ interviews and has been interviewed by 100+ companies in 5 years of career. And they are both in India and internationally with marquee brands, including Facebook, Amazon, Microsoft, Adobe, LinkedIn, etc. So now I would like to hand it over to Tushar.
Hi guys, thanks Ankita for a very brief introduction about the platform as well as for the purpose of this session. So as we guys know that this purpose of the session is to how we can crack the coding interviews of top tech companies, or how we can crack the tech interviews of these top tech companies. So let's straight away go through a PPT that I've prepared, which I would like to share with you guys, which covers all the bullet points that what's the process is behind when a person wants to switch to a different company. What is the process? There are basically 2-3 things that needs to be processed. It's a 3 to 4 months process, and what strategies we should follow, what things we should follow, how we should follow, and how we can make ourselves strong and positive so that we will land up a very good offer or a very good job. So let me share my screen. So as we know, this title, the how we can crack interviews of top tech companies. So as we know that there are basically two steps in any process. These are the basic two steps, that how can I get an interview calls, and if I am getting interview calls, then how can I crack the interviews. So for cracking the interviews, I need to prepare myself for the interview. If I am a front end engineer or a back end engineer or a full stack engineer or any or a DevOps or a QA, there is a process, or there is a sort of questions, or there is a sort of study material that is available online, or the set of round or interviews that I need to go through. So that is a separate process that I need to prepare, which will take some time. And the second process is, even if I'm very good at coding, but I'm very bad at networking, or my resume is very bad, or I'm not able to communicate my things to my seniors or my juniors of people, due to which I'm not getting interview calls. So these are the two things which are very, very important. Very, very frequent questions that I get from most of the people are like, sir, I'm very good at coding, but due to my college is not very good college, I don't get any interview calls, or something like that. My English is not good, that's why I don't get any interview calls. So all those things I'll discuss in this PPT, in this presentation, that how we can increase our percentage of getting interview calls more frequently, and how I can prepare myself by investing my time at the right direction, at right path, which will both help me to get the good offer from the top tech companies. So let's start with the next slide. So in interview preparation, what do we need to do? How to prepare for interview? The most important thing that we need to do is self-study. It's very, very, very important. You can hire a tutor, you can go to an institute, you can talk to your friends, seniors, but the only thing that it will help you is to self-study. Go online, take a paper and pen, open an ID and start solving questions, start reading questions, start studying. You need to start from very basic: arrays, strings, linked lists, queues, stacks, trees, graphs. These are the very basic data structural algorithms that you should definitely go through. Even if you are even if you're 10-year experience or a 5-year experience or a 2-year experience, you should invest most time in self-study. At least 2 to 3 hours daily after office hours, you should definitely invest your time in self-study, without even thinking that why are you studying? You are studying to crack an interview. For the first few months or for the first month, don't even think about the cracking an interview. Just study. Just go back to your college mindset. Open paper, take a paper pen and start solving questions. Very, very basic questions. So self-study is the very important thing. Second thing that I'll personally recommend, a lot of people don't do it, that they don't discuss things with their friends or their colleagues or their seniors or their family, that I'm looking for a change or I am finding this to be difficult. They think that if I'm studying online, if I'm taking a YouTube channel or YouTube tutorials or something like that, that is enough for me. But no, you should definitely discuss, talk to your friends, discuss questions with your friends. Ki, hey man, this is the question that I'm finding difficult. No matter what, it's a problem, like, and we all are engineers, so we meant to solve the problem. So just talk to your friends, talk to your minds, talk to your seniors about the mindset, about the problems that you are facing, and what kind of questions you are finding it difficult to solve. Because what I feel that most of the time when I am solving any problem, my mind is sort of biased about a particular solution and I cannot see the mistake in that solution. But moment I discuss that problem with someone else, I immediately connect with something better or something much far better problems or solution to that problem. So you should always have discussion with your peers or your seniors or your juniors or your teammates or your family members. Third is a mock interview. So once you are done with the questions, then you need to test yourself. I know that I know graphs. I know I've solved around 100 to 200, 200 questions. But even then, people find it difficult to crack the interview. Why? Because they don't practice themselves in that interview environment, in that 1 hour environment where the person has to solve one or two questions in a particular 30 to 40 minutes time duration or a 20 to 25 time duration. There's a set of criteria which on which every company judges you, that they look out how you speak, how you are considering the problem. Are you able to listen to the problem? Are you able to communicate your answer? Are you able to communicate the data points? On what basis you comes out to be a conclusion? So all those things will be covered in a mock interviews. Mock interviews, you can conduct mock interviews with your friends, with the people who are already looking for a change, or your seniors, or your teammates, or anyone online also on, or you can hire someone to take your interviews as well. And it's totally fine. You should definitely do mock interviews. Mock interviews, actually, it's like a real interview where you are actually interviewing for a company. It's just that that person will give you a detailed feedback just after the interview. And that is very, very necessary, especially if you are preparing yourself to for a very big companies, because in big companies, people judges you based on many points which you don't even realize that they judge you based on your way of speaking, the way of answering, the way of tackling the problem. They never expect you to solve a problem to the best solution. They always expect you to solve problem. They always expect test your approach to solve a problem. So your approach matters a lot, and that will be told by your friend or your interviewee in a mock interview. I think that's enough. That is being covered in the interview preparation. Let's move ahead. So that was the first leg, that interview preparation. So you guys both have to take the both legs parallelly. Like, I need to apply for interviews as well as I need to prepare for the interviews as well. So I'll say that now how to get interview calls. Most of the people think that I am such a good at coding, I don't need a good resume. No man, that's not true at all. Your resume is the first document that explains you and your nature and your culture and your background to recruiter for 15 to 20 seconds. Any recruiter spends only 20 to 30 seconds on your LinkedIn profile or on your resume. And what they are looking for? They are looking for what skills, what education and what work experience you have. So your resume should not have too long paragraphs or something. We will discuss in detail how a good resume look like. Then secondly, you need to contact recruiters. Whenever you're looking for a change, you yourself have to go to LinkedIn or any other platform, do some market research, talk to your friends, talk to your seniors, talk to different third-party recruiters, ping them, send them connection requests. If you have any email IDs or mobile numbers, call them, send your resumes to them, directly connect to them, try to talk to them directly, try to inform them, hey, hi, this is my profile and I'm looking for a change. I'm looking for, these are my criteria, these are my priorities, please help me out. They will definitely help you out, because recruiters also wants to reach out good talent. And if you also reach out to recruiters, recruiters do pay their attention and call you back. Third is the referrals. I personally find that referrals are the most beneficials in interview, in getting interview calls. Just imagine if I am working in a company and if I am I'm already hired by the company, so that means that company trusted my judgment, and if I am telling them that, hey, I am referring that person, please take interview for that person, that's very, very high probability that you will get an interview call. When you apply through careers page or you send your resume to recruiters, generally companies, recruiters get thousands of emails daily. It's not practically possible for a human eye to judge each and every resume based on the criteria. So in order to get an extra edge, you should definitely call your friends, your colleagues. And I also say that you can also connect to the random people on LinkedIn. Go to LinkedIn, go to that company page. Let's say if I want to apply to Amazon, I'll go to that Amazon page. I'll connect to 20 to 30 people. A few of the people will accept my request. And you can just send a message or an email to that person that, hey, hi, this is my name, this is my resume, I have this much experience, please refer me for this position. Always apply, always attach your resume and the interview and the job link as well for the other person to look at it, because that person will also spend only 2 to 3 seconds on that message. And never ever hesitate in asking for referrals, because if someone refers you, that person will get a referral bonus. So he's not making a favor to you. You are making a favor to that person. So never ever hesitate in asking for referrals. And referrals are the best thing to get connected and to get the interview calls. Also, whenever you ask for referrals, try to find those people who have some commonality in between you and the person. We'll discuss this point details in later. The last point I want to discuss is how you can get interview calls. You can apply through LinkedIn, you can apply through careers page. Just make sure that your LinkedIn profile is updated very well. Whenever you apply to careers page or whenever you send any email to a recruiter, do send it in a weekdays timing, as well as in the afternoon timing, from 11 a.m. to 2 to 3 p.m. because that is a peak time where the productivity and all the people are very active online. So the chances of anyone to see your email ID on top is very high. Let's move ahead to the next slide. Yeah, so let's discuss how we can self study. Ki bhai, okay, yeah, I need to study, but how to study, where to study, what to study. So what I'll do, first do some market research, like what kind of job you are looking, what kind of profile you already have. Let's say if I am a software developer, if I want to move to data science, it will not be easy for me. If I am a software developer, junior software developer, if I want to apply for senior software developer, there will be some high expectations expected from me. So I need to do some market research, try to note down what kind of companies you're targeting, whether you want a product-based company, whether you want a startup, whether you want to apply a big company. So based on that, go to their pages, go to different interview experiences of those companies, read those interview experiences, try to get an idea ki what kind of questions, what kind of rounds will that company will conduct. If some company is not conducting any machine coding round, then don't spend your time in solving those machine coding rounds. If some company values more towards the low level design and high level design, then you should definitely study low level design and high level design more. So all those things will help you out to do some, first you should do some market research, and then based on that, create or prepare your study material. Now there are some good websites like Geeks for Geeks, LeetCode, Glassdoor, CareerCub. I personally prefer Geeks for Geeks and LeetCode for coding questions and for even for theoretical questions and even for a lot of different questions that are available. Also, I'll recommend, interview experiences are very, very important. Interview experience, let's say if I want to apply for SG2 position at Amazon. First, let's go to the interview experience of Amazon SG2 positions. I'll read the questions, I'll check how many rounds do they conduct, how many, what kind of questions do they ask, so that I can prepare my mind that, okay, next 1 month, next 2 months, I need to focus my mind through that process. So the next point is writing code on paper, pen and debug. So guys, I have seen a lot of people just read the questions, just read the answers. They thought that, I know the concept of binary search. I will be able to solve every question of binary search. That's really not true. You should write code on paper pen and debug your own code. That's very, very, very important. Because when you give an interview, you generally have Google Docs with you, or you may go to, if it's an in-person interview, you will solve the questions on a whiteboard or a paper pen, where you don't have any ID with you. So that will not suggest you any autocomplete or something like that. So always prefer coding on paper pen and debug your code. Debugging your code is very, very important, because the moment you debug your code, you will immediately find your own mistakes. You will immediately find your edge cases to be covered. And it's always helpful for you to debug your code just for 2 minutes. Also, one more thing. So when you, let's say if I'm tackling some problem and I'm not able to get any solution, I go to a website, I read the solution, and then I thought that I know the solution. But after 2 days, again, you will find the same problem to be same difficulty. So that's where the debugging part comes. Whenever you read anyone else's solution, whenever you read anyone else's code on Geeks for Geeks or any lead code, you should debug that code, because the moment you will debug that code, you will understand the concept behind that code. So always write code on paper pen and debug. Then most of the people find difficult to solve HLD rounds or LLD rounds. So I'll prefer HLD rounds to be, you should study HLD rounds in two ways. First way is you should study your own architecture. You should study your own company's project. Even if you have never worked in that project or you have worked in a very small feature, you should talk to the other person. You should talk to the owner of that project that I want to understand end to end. I don't want to understand only the back end or the front end. Just try to get the end to end picture from the business, why the business started this project, what all steps my team did. Why did I choose to code in Java? Why not Python? Why did I choose to code in this MySQL? Why not MongoDB? Try to answer these questions for HLD rounds. If you understand your own architecture, if you understand your own project, that's itself an HLD. That's itself an architecture or system design. Secondly, there's a very good book called Grokking the System Design Interview. Just go to the online, try to read this book. This is the best book for HLD rounds you will ever find. It has all the points, what all points you should consider, on what basis you should take some decisions. That will even help you to design your own architecture in your own company as well. So I think HLD rounds, these are the two things that you should definitely do. And also mock interviews also will help you to solve or get confidence in HLD rounds, because HLD round is more or less of a experience based rounds, or more or sort of a theoretical based rounds. There is no particular solution to any HLD round. It depends on the public features, or it depends on the public requirement or a business requirement. The next is LLD rounds. So LLD rounds are basically low level designs. So low level design rounds are, I think you will easily get a lot of questions on Geeks for Geeks or Career Cup, where you will find that these are the criteria to solve an LLD round. There's a very good book called Design Patterns in Java. So those design patterns will also help you out to solve those low level design questions, and that's what exactly they look for, that how robust and how error free code that you can write, so that if, let's say, if you leave the company, the code should be so perfect, the code should be so good, the code should be so scalable, that even if you leave the company, or even if tomorrow the next any new feature comes, it should be done in a very less change of code, like by changing lesser number of lines, and the feature should be ramped, or any new person should be able to understand the code. So these are the things that a person should spend time in self-study, in market research, interview experiences, questions, LLD rounds, HLD rounds, and writing code on paper pen and debug. It's very, very, very important. Now the next part comes is resume. A lot of people don't even pay any attention to the resume, or people thought that resume is just a piece of paper. I am from very good college, or I have solved 200 questions. But see, resume is a very important point, because anyhow, anywhere you will apply, the first document you will ever note, you will ever touch base for your candidate is the resume. So resume should be very short, should be very crisp, and should have only the important bullet points. So I prepared a template for resume, which I personally find out, and I personally created based on my 5-year experience and after seeing a lot of resumes of people. So your resume should have your name, and only your phone number and email and your LinkedIn and GitHub profile if you have. You don't need to write any personal date of birth or any your address, your location and all this. Only this, these are the personal details that you should have. Then there's objective. So I found out it's a very debatable topic that a person should have an objective or not, a person should have an aim or not. I personally find out that person should not have any objective. It's like unless you have a very empty space on your resume page and you don't have enough material to write, then only you can write an objective. Otherwise, you can skip that part. Then I personally found that there are three sections that any recruiter will pay the most attention: experience section, education section, and technical skill section. What is the experience section? So experience section should have a list of your experience, work experience in a chronological order. It should have a company name, it should have a title and the duration from when to when I was working. And then it should have at least 2 to 3 lines of description about my projects or my role of experience. And those descriptions should be covered in a format of this format, like achieved X by doing Y percentage by doing Z. I personally find that if you add any data analytics points in your project description, that I optimized this API by reducing 5 milliseconds of page load time by changing API version from 1.0 to 2.0. So this whole description will tell other person that he knows or that candidate knows what he wants to do. He delivered the project and that project actually created an impact. So I think these are the three things that every project fulfills your criteria. So if you're not able to write in this format, just try to write the text tag that I've used in that project. And then when you apply for when interviewer asks you that, hey, what happened in this? How did you reduce your 5 milliseconds page load time? Then you should tell that person the whole details, like, okay, these are the text tag that I upgraded, or these are the bugs that we found out and etc. Then education section is very simple, is very common section. It should have your college degree, your college durations and your marks covered. And if you want, you can also mention some courses that you already studied. Then there's a technical skill section. Technical skill section is very important section. It will tell recruiter or any interviewer that what kind of skills you have. Let's say I'm a good Node.js developer, I am working in Java, I work in Python, I'm a backend developer, I'm a front-end developer. All those technologies, all those platforms, all those frameworks that I've used, I have knowledge of that I will mention in section. Then there is a last section that people generally name it as a hobby section or achievements or awards or all those sections. So you can club everything, all those points into one section, where you can mention your awards, or if your team awards, or your college, some college positions, or your extra positions, or something, your hobbies, or anything which basically portrays something else than your other three sections. That, okay, I'm a good trekker, or I'm a good singer, or what I'll do in something of personal time, or I'm a good team player, or I'm good in this part. So all those things you can mention in this achievement and hobby section. Then there are some points that I basically want everyone to take care of, that you should use some basic and easy font. You should never fantasize or color code your resume. The basic it is, the better it is. Your resume should be one page, unless you have more than 7 to 8 years of experience, where you can you have too many things to mention. Your resume should be one page. A lot of people put their profile picture as well. I don't think that for a tech background you need a profile picture in your resume. You can attach your LinkedIn profile links, that is enough. Don't attach your permanent temporary addresses. You don't need to write any horizontal border or something. I personally don't prefer any color coding. You should definitely make all your profiles, any coding profiles, any LinkedIn profile, any your portfolio, a hyperlink. That's very, very important. Most of the people just paste or just write the text. It should be clickable hyperlinks. Yeah, do get it reviewed from some senior professional or some friend, because I am again saying that a person whenever prepares some resume, he or she may get biased, or he or she may not get any in notice any things that which someone else can point it out. Then you should definitely avoid typos, avoid paragraphs that should only include the bullet points. Also, you can use any different templates or font or any design. That's your choice, but keep it professional. Like, it should look professional. Yeah, I think these are the few things that I'll like to point out for a resume. Yeah, now let's move to the next section. Yeah, so next section is recruiters and referrals. So how to approach recruiters? A lot of people ask me this question, ki sir, I know recruiters. I emailed so many resumes to recruiters or my friends or my seniors. Nobody replies. I don't know what to do. So these are the questions that people generally have there in mind. So guys, I like to say that don't think that if you're not getting any reply, that means that something is wrong in your profile or something is wrong in you. Because it can happen to a lot of people. It happens with me as well. I also apply to 100 companies and I don't get a reply. I only get reply about 10% of those companies. So that can happen. My resume can get missed, or maybe they don't like my profile, or maybe they don't think that I am a fit for their profile. So there can be n number of reasons, but you should be free to approach recruiters via email or mobile or LinkedIn profile. Don't hesitate in asking for referrals, or don't hesitate in asking for jobs to any recruiters or referrals. Don't think that if something goes bad or if something goes wrong, you will be barred from that company. Or most people think that I'm not prepared enough to apply for a company or something like that. Don't bring those points in applying, because if you don't apply, you are anyhow rejected. So always apply and always approach recruiters directly. Try to call them, try to WhatsApp them, try to email them, because they also want good talent, and they also want people to come to them. Obviously, it will save their own time. So, and that's their job to basically to call them and to find good talent for their company. You should definitely talk to your friends and colleagues who have recently changed or who are looking for a change. Though these people are very good people, because if a person recently changed, then he already has all the mobile numbers, email IDs, and he already knew that what companies are hiring, what companies are offering, what kind of profiling they are looking, what kind of interviews they are asking. And other people who are looking for a change, they also going through the process, so they also know that this company is offering this much, or hey, I have this email ID for that recruiter. Please send your resume as well. So you should be in touch with those people who have recently changed or who are looking for a change. Sometimes they are a best resource for you to apply for companies or to get interview calls. Then LinkedIn connections. LinkedIn connections are very good. You should definitely connect to more and more people of a particular company, and then you should definitely apply through and always try to find a connection of something in common. Let's say if I want to apply to a company, Amazon, and if I send a request to two people, one is from some one and that person and me have common college, the other person and me don't have any common thing. I personally tell you that the first person will definitely refer me. The chances of referring from that person is very high, because he always think that, hey, I know I am from that same background, and if I can come to this company, if I can join this Amazon company, why can't my junior or why can't my friend can do that? So if a common company or if a common college, even if a common location, sometimes that also works. So you should definitely find a connection with something in common. So that part comes in when you do some market research, or when you apply for when you want to get more and more recruiting calls. These are the things that people miss, and that's why people don't get much more interview calls. If you follow these tips, you will definitely find out that you will get more 50% calls than earlier. Then, okay, so these are the two things that we have discussed. We have discussed how to prepare, what to prepare, where to prepare. then this is the first process. Second process is that how to get more and more interview calls, what things I can improve in my resume to get interview calls, how to approach recruiters, how to ask for referrals, how to with whom I need to connect, like the people who are looking for a change, my seniors, my folks, how to study. We had discussed that that we should study from these XYZ platforms, we should debug our code, we should write the code on paper pen, what to study. I told you that you guys need to do some market research based on your own profile, that if I'm a data scientist or if I'm applying for a senior position, if I'm applying for a manager, then these are the points that these will be the points that I will be judged. So I need to prepare, focus on those points. And in the last, I prepare some things that I think that most of the people have those things are in their mind, but because of some taboos or some things, people don't discuss those points, or people don't even apply to the companies thinking that these are the points I will have and I won't be get selected. So I think most of the people don't even talk to their friends and connections whenever they are looking for a change. Guys, please talk to your friends, please talk to your seniors, please talk to your colleagues, please talk to your teammates, someone who is senior to you or someone who understands you, because they will definitely help you to for your betterment. Don't think that you are alone, you're standing or you're traveling alone in this journey. A lot of people think what you are thinking as well. So just talk to your peers, talk to different people. It will definitely help you. Second point is fear of rejections. A lot of time I've seen, in fact, I also used to have that fear of rejections when I was in my early career, that dude, I won't be even selected for Google, then what's the point of applying in Google? So that's very, very bad. If I don't apply to a company because I feel that I will be rejected, then I'm already rejected. So don't ever have the fear of rejections. Rejections and failures will definitely make you a better person. You don't need to go to 10 companies. You don't need 10 offers. You need only one offer. But it's very important to apply in as many companies important to put the effort without having the fear of rejection. Don't have rejection. Nobody will, you yourself won't remember after, once you get a good offer from other company, that hey, I was rejected from XYZ company, now what will happen with my life. So don't ever feel that fear of rejections. Third point is very, very important. A lot of people have that persona or have that notion in their mind that since I'm not good, I'm not from tier one college, I won't be get selected, or my resume will not be shortlisted. Guys, I am telling you, I also used to have the same notion in my mind when I was in my college, but I found out after working in big companies and after spending 6 years in this industry, I found out that more than 50% people in tech industry in big companies are not from tier one college. You can go to any company's page, any company's LinkedIn page, check out the engineer's profile. You will find out that most of the people are not from tier one colleges. And I found out that my personally as well, like I went to different companies, I worked in different companies, I found out that 90% people were not even have any big brand tag name in their college. So don't believe, and I personally thought that nobody even cares. If you are interviewing for a company, if you have the skill set, if you have solved big problems, if you have good in what you are, and if you have all the stuff which that company needs, nobody cares about your college name. This is absolutely true. Fourth is have patience and study. Guys, you need to understand that no matter what, how many interview calls you get, what college background you have, how good in your speaking skills, you should have patience and study. Don't think that it's just a matter of 1 week, it's just a matter of 1 month. Do take some time, do spend some time, because it's a matter of 5 years. If you're looking for a change, do take a call based on multiple parameters. It's a long-term commitment. Don't take these decisions in very hurry. Have patience. Even if you're getting rejected multiple times, don't apply. Take some time, study well for 1 month or 1.5 month, then again apply. but have patience and study. Study, it's very, very, very important. Then you need to study a lot of material. You need to understand the question. You need to understand the approach. You should enjoying study. Then only you will be able to get into good colleges or good companies or something. Because even if after cracking those interviews, once you start working in that company, those things will be expected from you. That that person will automatically study online and do some research and then comes out to the problem. And last point is think long term. Don't take decisions for 1 year or maybe 6 months call that chalo, let's go to this company, or after that I'll again switch after 3 months or 6 months. Because that process that will waste your 6 months or 3 months, absolutely. So think in long term. It's not a short call, it's a very long goal. Have patience, study well, take time, talk to people, discuss with your people, do spend time on your profiling, do spend some time on your resume, study at least 2 to 3 hours daily and at least 4 to 5 hours on weekends, and do end-to-end market research. What kind of interest you have, it's very important. If you go to some good company and if you don't go to some good team, that is also very bad. That will come out to be very bad in future. So do take some time. Do take some time on which team you are hiring for. And it's not an easy task, but it's not very difficult task as well. And yeah, I think these are the points that I need to that I want you guys to always remember in your mind. Yeah, I think thank you guys. That's it from my side. Ankita, can you take over?
Yeah, sure. Okay, so that was some great dose of motivation for people who are currently or want to apply for top companies. Okay, so the presentation is done now, what we will be doing next is that we'll be taking all the questions from Slido first. That is the link that we had shared with our audience before this session, and then we'll take all the questions from the questionnaire section. But I would like to tell you all that I have shared a few links in the chat section for all our social handles, Instagram, LinkedIn, Recro's YouTube channel. You guys can also join our front-end community on WhatsApp, back-end, Android, iOS, React, and DevOps, and even share the same links with our colleagues as well. And I've also shared Tushar's and as well as my LinkedIn profile if you wish to connect with us directly. Also, we have a community on Meetup also, so you guys can join there as well. And last but not the least, so if you guys like the session, then please do share your valuable feedback with us at the link that I've shared in the chat. That's very important for us to know whether we are doing good or not. And if any improvements are required, then we'll definitely love to work on that. Okay. And before I take any questions, and as I said that this was a very great, great dose of motivation for all of us, then I would also like to add something to it. So I'm working at Swiggy and as a part of Recruit only, and it took me about 45 days to get the job at Swiggy through Recruit, obviously. But yeah, I didn't give up hope. I prepared myself totally to face any company, be it Swiggy, be it a big startup like Swiggy, or be it a new startup like any other company. I got many options, but I was preparing myself for the best, and I got the best. So let's move ahead and take the questions from Slido. So Tushar, I'll just start reading out the questions, and you can start answering sure. them. Okay, so the first question that we have is, how can we approach MNC before the interviews? And I have applied for various MNCs so far, and my profile got no reply. So what's the solution?
Yeah, so I think I've already discussed this thing in the presentation as well, that there are n number of reasons that your profile is not getting shortlisted. there are two three things. First is that your profile may not be a good fit for that company, so you don't need to worry about that thing. You can see that there are thousands of jobs available online. If your profile is not getting shortlisted in an MNC, that doesn't mean that your profile is not good. Your profile, that same MNC have 100 of jobs available. You can apply in some other job, and before applying to a job, just check that if you meet the basic qualifications for that job. If that job profile says that I need to have 4 years experience, and if you have 2 years experience, many recruiters straight away reject your profile. So wait for some 2 years experience profile opening, then only apply. And if that profile says that we need a Node.js developer, I personally remember I applied for a profile of Node.js developer, and I don't know how to code in Node.js, and my profile was straight away rejected with this reason. So it's okay to get rejected from that profile, but try to find those positions or those profile where your resume should complement their profile, because then you will also enjoy working in that profile only. Unless if you want to switch to something different domain, then that way you should talk to your friends who will refer you, because then obviously if I'm applying for that position, my recruiter don't know me, recruiter will never hire me, because will never call me, because he has 10 profiles in front of him. Why will he choose a profile who doesn't even know a Node.js? But if someone is your friend, if he or she can pitch personally to recruiter that, hey, I know that person, he's very hardworking person, and she's already started working on Node.js, she's very beginner in that, please interview that person. So that's how, if you want to apply, that's how you can get more interview calls from my MNCs.
Okay. So the next question that we have is that how to get interview calls. I mean, it's part of the first question itself, but
yeah. So I think I've already explained a lot of things how to get interview calls. Like, you can talk to for referrals, you can apply through recruiters, talk to the people who are looking for a change, get connected on LinkedIn, try to find those connections on LinkedIn which you and that person have something in common. The chances of getting referred from that person increases. Let's say if I'm working on Amazon, if I'm a junior, my college junior asked me to refer him, just because he was my college junior or that person is from my college, I have that extra sense of personal attention on that resume, and the chances of me referring that person increases. So try to ask those people which have something in common with you.
Great, thanks. Next question that we have is, someone is struggling on the video coding interviews.
So for those things, it's very new these days. I also used to be I used to prefer only face-to-face interviews, because that's how I can show my body language and I can show my confidence to that person better as per came to video calling. But what I'll say that you should prefer two three things. That's where the mock interview part comes. So what you should do, you should first of all code on paper pen or Google Docs. You should have that practice coding on paper pen or Google Docs, so that if you want to interview online, most of the time you need to solve coding on Google Docs. So that first thing. Secondly, you should do mock interviews. Mock interviews plays a very important role, because mock interviewer will give you a feedback, ki dude, your body language should be this way, you should first ask these questions, and you should structure your answer in this format. So I think those things will help you to crack or be better tell your approach in a better way in a video recording interview.
So the next question is I believe this is covered, but if you would like to still answer it, that how to ask for referrals.
Yeah, again, that's find some common person in that connection, or directly ask people, random people, because always remember that you are making a favor to that person who is referring you, because that person will get a referral bonus from that company which is worth 50,000 or 1 lakh. And I have seen even some companies offers 1.5 lakh rupees for a referral bonus. So don't ever hesitate in asking for referrals. Just ask referral that, hey, hi, this is my profile, this is my resume, and always attach the job link as well, because the person who is referring you will never have any, will never put this effort that he will go to his own company's careers page, find a good profile for you, because that it's not his job or that person's job. So that's the recruiter's job. So if you want to save that time, attach your resume, your profile, and your and the job link that you are interested in. That's how you should ask for reference.
So just I'd like to add a point here that, like, people can also reach out to the recruiters who have posted the job in this case, or if it's from someone who says that they are from tier 2 or 3 college, and is it okay for them to apply in big companies like Google and Amazon?
Absolutely true. I've told you, only skills matters. Your resume, your college brand name, you can yourself go to so many any company's page, try checking out 50 people's engineers profile, and you will find out that more than 50% people are not from good college. Well, not from tier one college. I'm not saying any other college not a good college. I'm just saying that because of the brand name, people do get some edge case in, do get some extra benefit at the time of application. But at the interview process, nobody will prefer you over some IITian or over some good college person. Let's say if I am the CEO of any company and I'm interviewing two people, and I see that the other person who is not an IITian, that person is able to solve all the questions, why won't I hire him? I always prefer good talent over good college, and most of the people have that notion. So don't worry about your college thing. Just apply, just practice, study, and apply.
So the next question that we have is, like, people get challenges of interviews of companies that prefer DS or Algo, or versus companies that prefer deep tech knowledge. Like, people get confused, like, which shall they prepare for?
Yeah, okay. So I'll say that I can say that for computer science profile or for software engineering profile, DS Algo is very, very, very must. Like, a person should, DSLGO is like ABCD of English. Whenever we are in nursery class, we study ABCD for a year. So DSLGO is that kind of thing for a computer science, because no matter what kind of technology stack you're working, front end, DevOps, back end, QA, full stack, you need to understand what is happening behind the code, what is happening inside the code. So DSLGO is always must. Then deep tech knowledge. Okay, so it depends on different companies. Like, I have seen some companies do ask some questions on operating system, some companies do ask questions on networking, some companies do ask questions on some other microprocessor. So it depends on that company's business value as well. Let's say if I remember I interviewed for a multiplayer gaming company. So that company asked me a lot of questions on networking, and I didn't study networking very well, so I got rejected. So, but that doesn't mean, so it depends on the company's business use case as well, that if that company prefer those people who are good in networking, so it's okay. So but yes, you should definitely study DSLGO for most, you should study DSLGO. And then deep technologies depend on the kind of companies or profile that you are applying for.
Okay. So the next question that we have is, what if I have a gap in my work experience and want to get back into the top tech companies? How does someone prepare for it?
Yeah. So there are many reasons of that gap. Let's say if I am not feeling well, or there's something happened in my family, or I was up studying for a, like, you can cover that gap in multiple reasons. You can say that I was preparing for CAT, or I was preparing for any further studies exams, I was preparing for any government exams, but now I'm back, I want to join back this industry. And obviously you will have that 1 year gap, so you may find it difficult in the starting. But you should, what you should do, you should, first of all, you should be good in your skill set. You should study. If you want, you can do some project. You can do your project, some online project on your own. You can do some online course, and you can put that course in your resume that I have a certification in that course, and I did this project in this past 6 months while studying for the CAT exam or while studying for this thing. So that's how you can cover that thing, and that's how you can cover that thing. But don't worry about the gap part. There can be n number of reasons that you can do, and generally most of the people don't really, these things don't really bother, unless if these things are bothering, then you should definitely try to contact recruiters directly or ask your friends to refer you. In all these scenarios, referrals are the best thing, because they know you personally, and that person will pitch recruiter personally that, hey, I know that person, and just because this thing, he wasn't able to apply for last 1 year, but now he wants to come back to his industry. So that's how you can cover.
Okay. So the next question that we have is, it's sort of covered, but if you want to answer it again, how to prepare for a design and architecture round?
Yeah, so design and architecture rounds are basically HLD and LLD. HLD, I'll say that you should focus on two things. First is you should understand your own project. If you have solved only simple bug or a simple small feature in this project, and the project is very big, try to understand end-to-end picture of that project. You don't need to go in detail, just understand that how and what technology stack you guys have used in that project and why you used. It doesn't matter if you used MySQL or MongoDB. The question is, why do you use MySQL and why didn't you use MongoDB? That question, if you able to understand that part, that will solve your 50% design rounds. So, and the second part is Grokking. Grokking is a very good book, or you can do mock interviews. You can study online for HLD rounds, and for LLD rounds, you should study design patterns, and or you should study some questions on Geeks for Geeks or Career Cup, like how to design a book my show, how to design a chess player game, all these questions. Try to solve those questions in hand. Don't think that you are too good to solve those questions. Do solve 3 to 4 questions of LLD rounds in properly solving questions in your ID or on paper pen. Do spend some time in solving these questions.
Okay, so the next question that we have is, why does interviewer wants to hear the theoretical definition of the terminologies instead of the practical usage?
So again, whenever I interviewed for companies, I've seen these things very, very less. It depends on a company to company. Some companies have those kind of culture, or maybe those companies have come to those kind of product that they want their engineers to be have a deep tech knowledge rather than a practical knowledge. So I say that I personally see that there are the percentage of such companies or interviews are very, very less. And if it's like if I want to apply for that position, and if that position expect me to have that knowledge, then I have to study. It's that thing. And if I don't want to study, that means I don't want to apply for that company. So it's always true, but it depends on company to company and the position to position.
Okay, so the next question that we have is, if a startup designates a lead profile to a 2 years experience resource, what should be the approach while joining an MNC, as those companies need 5 years experience lead?
Okay, so see, don't think that a startup, so let's say if I am working in a startup and I have a 2-3 year experience, my team was 20 people team and we were handling a $50 million business. When I moved to, and I was a tech lead there, because that's the kind of responsibility I was doing as well. I was spending my 10 hours a day. I was even working on weekends. I have the responsibility. If something goes wrong, it directly impacts the business. So that kind of responsibility that I had. But when I moved to an MNC, MNC have thousands of engineers. They have a $1 billion business. When I'm working, move to a team, that team itself is handling a product which itself is delivering $50 million business to that company. So obviously it makes sense. And also there's a lot of architecture that already being set up in that company. There's a work-life balance that they are giving you. So it's okay, and it's very highly chances that I won't get tech lead profile and I get some senior developer or maybe some other profile based on 5 year experience. So that's very common. And obviously, like, if a person is a CTO in a startup, that doesn't mean he will become a CTO of a very big company. He will become a director or maybe a senior developer or maybe a tech lead kind of person or maybe a senior architect kind of person. So I don't think the profile name matters. What matters is that if I have a 10 year experience in a startup, I should get an equivalent 10 year profile on that MNC. That's because the kind of responsibility and the kind of answerability I have, that will be equal in both the businesses. So that should not change. But on paper, if they are calling you architect, on paper, if they are calling you developer or some other director, I don't think that really matters. The kind of matters is that kind of responsibility that you have in both the businesses.
Tushar, I have I have to add here. So what if the job I am applying for asks for 5 years of experience and I have say 3.5 years of experience? Two is very less, no one would consider, that's understandable. But what if I just have 3.5 years of experience? But I have worked on quite a few projects. In fact, they are quality projects, big projects, quality projects. Like, how do I make the recruiter see that first? How do I highlight it?
Okay, so yeah, that's a very good question, Ankita. I personally applied using that thing as well. Like, I was having a 4 year experience, and I used to apply for 6 year experience jobs. So first of all, yes, it depends. Again, it's a demand and supply. If a recruiter is able to get 6 year experience profiles with all the points covered, and if I am applying as a 4 year experience with all the points covered, that person will definitely prefer a more experienced person over me. So that comes a demand and supply. But even then, I think that, hey, I am eligible, I am good in that technology, please take my interview. So that's where either I can talk to that recruiter directly on LinkedIn or over call or over email, or I can show some my project links. If I have a live running project, I can attach that project there rather than explaining that person that I did XYZ ABCD. I will show the project key. This is the project that I did, these are the apps that I developed. Maybe after that, that person will definitely try to call me. Or referrals again comes. Referrals are a very strong chances of getting you interview calls. This is where the referral will come part, it will come in the picture, that hey, I know that person, please hire him, please take interview of that person, because he has or she has all the skills that is required for this profile. So that's where these are the things that we should definitely try to bridge this 2 years or 3 years experience gap.
Oh, that was a great answer. Referrals is the solution.
Yes, referrals are very good solutions. Yeah. I personally preferred referrals always than any other thing.
Great. So let's move on to the next question. Okay, so it is it okay to discuss about your package with friends or packages in general actually?
Yeah, I think it's completely fine. I personally do that. And see, compensation is a very important part whenever a person is switching a job. All the people don't say it, but it matters. At the end, this thing matters a lot. And if you won't discuss the package with your friends or recruiters or any other person, there are very many ways to discuss your package. Don't tell about your package. Maybe you can tell the expectations. Let's say if I am earning 10 lakhs a year and if I want to apply a 20 lakh a year job, then I will automatically apply for those companies only which will offer me that kind of range. So how will I do that? By asking people, by asking seniors, by asking friends, and those people who are looking for a change these days, because they've already interviewed in some companies, maybe they already have some offers as well, so they can give you some inside information that these are the range that they are offering or this much high percentage that they are offering. So it's okay to discuss package. Maybe some people don't discuss it with the same experience level, but you should definitely discuss your packages with your seniors. 4 or 5 years experience, more experience than you. those people will definitely guide you because they've already been with your footsteps, so they know and they will definitely help you. 9 out of 10 people will definitely help you. So it's okay to discuss.
I also agree with this point that it's okay to discuss about the packages, because that then only you can know about the market. And also, like, whenever someone is approaching you, like a recruiter maybe, they quote you X amount. Okay. But the company may be capable of X plus 4 or X plus 6. And you must be like, maybe you deserve at least X plus 3 amount. So you should know that. So that can, you can only know that with market research or discussing with your friends, because they'll be having their friends and maybe in that particular company which you are applying for. Okay. So the last question from Slido that we have is, what are the best resources to get started to face the tech interviews with the companies like Google, Microsoft on algorithms and data structures from the very core level?
Okay. I'll say that what I did, and then I'll say what you guys can do. Whenever I switch for a company, I firstly prefer Geeks for Geeks for questions, practice for theoretical knowledge. I prefer LeetCode for actually solving the questions on a platform. These are the two platforms that I do very actively. Then there are HackerRank, then there are HackerEarth. On HackerEarth also you will find a lot of people solving different contests. A lot of companies also host many coding contests over HackerEarth. Based on that as well, you can get interview calls. I also prefer for HLD, I prefer the Grokking interview. The system designs. For LLD, I prefer design patterns by Java. There's a website called Career Cup. Career Cup is also a very good website, which is very good for Google. Then there is a website called CodeForces. CodeForces is a very similar platform like CodeChef, which was developed by Google. And sometimes I've seen that Google asked to same questions as available on CodeForces. So CodeForces is also a good platform. Other than that, I think these are the, and then there are now these days there are many more platforms added, like there are many YouTube tutorials or there are many paid services as well. That's your call, that's your own choice, but I think these are the few 5-6 websites that I'll definitely and there's a website called Glassdoor is also a very good website. Glassdoor, most of the people post questions and interview experiences. There also you will find good study material for the companies like Google, Microsoft, Amazon, LinkedIn, Adobe. Yeah.
Great. So we are done with all the questions from Slido. Now we'll be taking all the questions that you guys have posted in the question section on Airbnb. Also, I can already see that there are upvotes for some of the questions, but those who haven't tried this can upvote any question if you also have the same doubt and you want to want us to answer that first, because we'll be answering all the questions with the most upvotes first. Okay, so shall I start reading out these questions, Tushar?
Yeah, sure.
Thanks. So the first question, how to handle the situations like in your current job, you're working with certain technology, say JavaScript, and want to switch to a profile whose requirements are completely different technology, say Java.
Yeah. So, yeah, a lot of people have this kind of doubt. I also have this kind of doubt that I don't. So there are 2-3 things what you should do. First thing is that if you really want to switch your domain, if you really want to switch your tech stack, first don't try to switch. Try to switch in your own company or in your own team. If you are working in a startup or if you're working in a big company, try to talk to your manager that, hey, I am already have knowledge of JavaScript. I want to apply something on Java or Android or something else. Can I get some project on that? Rather than switching to a new company, because that will be more challenging. Other than that, stay in the same company, spend 2 months on a new technology, test yourself that whether you even like Java or not, because you are already a good JavaScript developer. So I think first is you should definitely work in the same company and try to get a new project in the same company. If that doesn't work, you can apply for any online course. Don't do it for the sake of certificate. once you do that course, if it's a free or a paid, doesn't matter. You should do one project after that course. That project will actually adds the value of the course. Otherwise you will definitely forget everything that you studied in this course. So do a project after that, any online project, any freelance project. There are many projects that is already uploaded on GitHub. Go to that project, read the project, add any PR, submit any code review or that. Try to contribute in open source. That is a very good platform or things that you should definitely practice when you want to switch to a new tech stack. Last option, that you want to apply for some other company in a Java and you already a JavaScript developer, then you should study specifically Java interview questions. Specifically, you should at least know how to code in Java, because that's very, very important. And most of the companies don't even prefer the language that you already know. What they prefer is the thought and the approach that you have in the behind. It happens with me as well. The current project that I'm working on, that is in Python. I have never studied anything in Python. I was never even interviewed for Python. And Python is just a language. What they interviewed me for, DSLGO. And the moment I joined the company, they gave me a project of Python. And it took me around 1 to 2 months just to understand the project. So that happens, but that happens in a, like, sometimes that also happens. So there are three things. First, in the same company. Second is the do any online course. Or third is at least know how to code in that language so that you can apply or you're able to solve the interview questions in other companies.
I would like to add to that, Tushar, may I?
Yeah, sure. Please do that.
Okay. So I have friends who also want to switch their domain, but they do not have any opportunities in their company, in their current company. So my advice to them has been that, say, if you want to change your domain, be ready to start from scratch. Because if you do not have any opportunity in the same company you are currently working with, you might get an opportunity in a new company, but they might appoint you as a fresher only. So that's what we have to be ready for if we are willing to change our domain. We are so interested in that. So that's a kind of risk also. But if you are passionate about it, you should go ahead with it.
Yeah.
So next is, I have one question. Can we get offer from startup and then try for MNC company?
Yes, 100%. There is no doubt in that. You can have any startup offer. You can have any MNC offer. That should not bother you to not apply for any other company.
I think the problem that people face here is, in this scenario, is that in startups, there's a lot of workload, because of which they are not able to prepare for those MNCs. But I think if you're getting more work, then, and if you really want to get into an MNC, you have to take out time to prepare for it. I mean, there is no other solution. Yes. I can see.
Yes. Preparation needed for all the companies. These days, if you apply for a startup, if you apply for MNC, you can see that the hiring process, both people will grill you according to their talent, according to their needs. And if companies are paying you so high, they will definitely expect you more and more things to do. And that's preparation needed for both of them.
Okay. So next we have is, any idea how to apply for jobs in abroad?
Yeah. So that's also very similar to what I told you. You can approach out to recruiters. You can go out to their careers page. Directly go to that careers page and apply. Secondly, go to LinkedIn. If you see any opening, you can apply through LinkedIn, easy apply. Thirdly, if you have someone working in that company, someone from your own background, you can approach that person. Or even if some random connection on LinkedIn, you can approach that person that, hey, hi, this is my profile, please refer me. So that's how you can apply. For the application process is same as compared to India, as well as compared to abroad countries. One thing I noticed in the abroad countries is that they also expect a cover letter. So I've always seen that the people, the recruiters in abroad countries do pay attention on cover letter as well. So cover letter is a very simple format where you just need to explain what you want to do and what you have did, so or what you already did. So, and that what you want to do should complement the job application, the job description, because if that recruiter will find out that he did that project or he wants to do in this Java, and that's what we require, the Java developer. So I think cover letter adds an extra element in when you apply for abroad countries.
Okay, so request from my side to the audience is that if you like this session, then please take a screenshot and post it on LinkedIn tagging Recro, and you already have Recro's profile link. Okay, next question. Please suggest some good projects idea which will add value in the profile. Looking for full stack projects specifically.
Okay, for full stack project, you can develop any game or any app, any simple web app or maybe an Android app, which will just it will have a login logout system. It will have or maybe don't even login logout. It will have just any kind of interaction game, any click game or any motion sensor game. That is a very good full stack project, because that will have a backend architecture as well as a front end architecture. Or you can develop any website, because website also will have a full stack project. You can develop any kind of information website, any kind of dynamic website, like people can go there, can create an account, can get some information, can raise a query. Or you can develop a forum. Forum is a very popular, is a very easy and a very popular project where a set of people, a common set of people are meeting and creating groups, discussing and replying and creating accounts. So I think these are the two, three projects that are very easy and very easy to do and have full stack architecture.
How about an e-commerce platform, Tushar?
Yeah, e-commerce is also doable, but that requires a business. Like, you need to sell something, you need to someone has to pay, you know, to maintain inventory and itinerary. So that requires more of a business value. But if you not want to do any business, you just want to create an app or a website for people to interact without and it's a free of cost just for the sake of project. So that's what you can do. E-commerce will require something selling, something buying, return, everything, invoicing.
Yeah, got it. Thank you.
That will, in fact, that will even require any proper PAN card and proper GST number and everything.
Correct.
Yeah.
Okay, so next we have is, what if my projects aren't much challenging, or like, will they affect my chances of shortlisting?
What if my projects aren't much challenging projects? See, there are two things. First is you need to showcase your project that it is a challenging project. How you can showcase your project? I told you that description, that achieved X by Y percentage by doing Z. If you yourself do the changes in your own resume, and you will find out that the moment you will showcase your project in this way, it will automatically add a very good value to your own project. So it's always how you explain your project. Sometimes also it's not very important what you already did, what's your vision in that project, because obviously Facebook didn't become this big in just 1 year. In the first year, Facebook was just a platform to connect to friends and share pictures, and that's it. But now Facebook is a multi-billion dollar business. So but how did it become? Because the vision was very good. So your project should be, even if your project is at a prototype, but your what you want to achieve in the future, that is also, if you are able to communicate that thing in your interview, I think that will automatically create a challenge and showcase the challenge of your project.
Okay. So next we have is, how to prepare for behavioral or functional interviews?
Okay, so I personally think that in tech interviews, behavioral thing matters on a very small scale level. I have never seen any particular interview only to judge you on your behavior. Every interviewer will have 2-3 points, like whether that person was able to listen the question first, that person took some time to approach, that person didn't rush into anything. So these are the 2-3 things that that's what they judge you. Obviously other things goes by default, like the attitude and the kind of approach, the kind of language that we are using, the kind of eye contact thing, and those are the some behavioral things. But I've never seen a particular interview going for only for this thing. Manager, generally in manager round, they judge you on the basis of whether you will be fit, you will be a good culture fit for that company. So it happens with me as well. I also got rejected from a very big company, and I think I was rejected because of the behavioral round, or maybe because they think that I will not be good fit for that company's culture. So, but that it's okay. That should not bother you to apply, or that should not make you sad, because it's okay to not go to that company where you will not be a good fit, even if you are a very good coder, because in long term it will definitely make you it will be problematic for you. So it's okay to get rejected from those companies, and yeah, that's from my side. Like just be yourself, just be true to yourself, and that's it. That should be enough.
Okay, so the next question that we have is, okay, so Tushar, what career coaching services do you offer?
What kind of career coaching do you offer? Okay, thank you for asking this question. So basically I recently started offering few of the services, like mock interviews. I do freelance Java interviews, I do mock interview sessions, I do resume review services. I constantly connect with that person. It's a 1.5 month long duration course, where or a 2 month course. It's a totally flexible course. We connect with each other, we discuss each other problems. I'll guide that person. I will only guide that person. I will not make him study. That person will study himself. I will just do the mock interviews, and I will also help that person how to reach out to recruiters. It's a very it's on a very starting level. I've only have successfully converted 4 to 5 students, or 4 to 5 working professional people. But yeah, it's that's the services that I have.
Okay, so the next question that we have is our next is, how to keep ourselves motivated throughout the whole journey of development?
That's very good question. I think that's at the end, this is the only thing that matters. No matter what, where are you working? If you are working in a very big, I've seen a lot of people working in Google, Microsoft in California, and they don't feel that they are making a change. And I've seen that person working in a 2 people startup in Gurgaon or in Delhi or in any peer location, and that person is feeling so much motivated, and if he's making the change, he's making an exchange. So guys, motivation is very important. It comes and goes. At least that's what happens with me. It comes and goes. In order to feel motivated, you should sometimes make your own effort, do something extra than your own company. Do spend some 3 to 4 hours over weekend on some other platforms, solve questions, or try to contribute to open source, try to read stuff, try to study stuff, which is like, I have never said networking, but one day I was just went through that how do we send out the emails to different people. So I just study that process, that okay, these are some protocols, or this is how we do that. I still don't remember what was that process, but that 3 to 4 hours thing actually motivated me, and actually diverted my mind from something which I was doing since last 6 months. So I think these are the things that you should do. Secondly, you should talk to people. If a person is feeling sad, or if a person is not feeling good, or if a person is feeling demotivated, talk to your manager, talk to your senior, talk to your company friend or someone else in your family. And that happens, that's very, very natural to feel demotivated. These are the things that will make you motivated. Appreciate your teammates' work. Sometimes what we do, even if by appreciating someone else's work, we feel motivated that, yeah, he is in my team or she is in my team. She has delivered such a good project. I should go and I should study and I should ask her or him that what points he or that she did to get it delivered. That will also motivate me. That since we both are at the same platform, same team, same structure, if she or he can do it, I can also do it. So that these are the few things that a person should definitely do to motivate himself or herself.
So that was all the questions that we had. Let's wait for a couple of minutes. Like, people might ask questions. Like, audience will wait for a few more minutes. If you have any questions, please shoot. Okay, so we have another question. Okay, so it's an seems like an incomplete question, but I read it out.
When solving questions, data structure wise, when solving questions,
they appear easy, but not when doing a challenge.
Okay, yeah, that happens. So by challenge, let's say if you are making a game, let's say if you are making a, okay, you guys remember we used to play a snake game in our very old Nokia mobiles. So in that mobile, if you notice, that's what it was. It was a shortest path algorithm. It was a 2D matrix, and you are going from position A to position B, and you are making a shortest path, and then you are adding that point in your own body, and then your body increases. So that's what it is. That's all. That was a 2D graph or 2D matrix problem, where a person is going from A to B, and there are hurdles. So if you touch that hurdle, you will die. So try to visualize your own problems when you're solving a data structure problem in this project. So it will become easy. Obviously, if you make this game will have 15 to 20 problems solved in just one project. So that's how you should look for a bigger picture. Like if you have a phone directory, phone book. So you type TUS and you will directly go to that person's contact. How does it happen? So it's like a dictionary. That's how you look at a dictionary. You go to T, then you go to U, and then you go to S. So if you look at this problem, then you will understand that this is how the tri data structure work. So just try to visualize the same problems with a real life examples. Then it will become easier for you.
Okay, so I think that's all now. I think we don't have any more questions. Okay, so just a second. So I'd like to thank you, Tushar, for a very informative session and for motivating everyone so greatly, because I think now most of the people will be ready to at least start preparing for these MNCs if they have been in fear of getting rejected also. Then so audience, for you also, we have had some great questions from your side as well, and we loved answering all your questions, and we would just again request you to share your feedback. If you see we can improve in any area, we would love to get a feedback from you and love to improve on that. Oh, Tejas says Tushar has a lot of passion for sharing his knowledge, like his energy.
Thank you,
Tejas.
Thank you guys.
Sana says me too. Oh, great.
Yeah, thank you Sana, thank you Ankita for this session. It was really nice talking to you guys and connecting people. I hope this will make definitely a good change in people's life and my own life as well. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tushar. Also, audience, if you want to directly connect with Tushar for his courses, then you can connect with him on LinkedIn. We have already shared his profile link with you guys. Also, if you have more friends who would like to be a part of a community, front-end, Android, iOS, back-end, DevOps, then you have our links, WhatsApp community links with you as well. There you can come up and tell us if you want us to do another session on a particular topic, or if you yourself want to contribute to this, we would love to have you as a speaker also. So please go ahead and join the groups if you wish to. And thank you so much, Tushar, for today's session.
So, thank you. Thank you, guys. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.